In 1791, English philosopher and social reformer Jeremy Bentham proposed a new kind of prison. The prison was round, with cells on the outer walls. In the center was a tower manned by one or more guards. From the tower, guards had a direct view into each cell. Prisoners had no privacy. Everything they did was visible. The view into the tower, however, was blocked. So while the guards could see each inmate, the inmates could never see the guards. This was the first surveillance state, a population controlled not by force, but by an asymmetric vision. The genius of the system was that the prisoners never knew when they were being surveilled and thus had to assume they were always being watched. They would therefore surveil themselves, censoring their own behavior to conform to the will of the invisible eye in the central tower. Each prisoner became complicit in their own subjugation. Bentham called his prison the Panopticon, Greek for all-seeing, and described it as a new mode of power, of mind over mind. In essence, the Panopticon replaced the social control exercised by an all-seeing, all-powerful God with an all-seeing and all-powerful state apparatus. For the prisoners, the state had become the new God. This was the mode of social control George Orwell predicted in his book 1984. In that book, the technology is electronic, but the principles remain the same. The hero, Winston Smith, and the citizens of his country, Oceania, are controlled by an asymmetric vision. In every room of every apartment is a so-called telescreen that delivers state propaganda, but whose real function is as a surveillance camera that can never be turned off. Each telescreen weaponizes the gaze of state power, the Ministry of Truth. Society itself has become a surveillance state, a prison, and the citizens assume they are always being surveilled. As with the prisoners, the citizens of Oceania become complicit in their own subjugation, censoring their behavior to conform to the will of the all-seeing and all-powerful state. Big Brother is watching you. Orwell died in 1950, fearing his vision of a totalitarian order might still come to pass. Yet today, only a handful of societies would qualify as Orwellian surveillance states: North Korea, urban China, and, of course, Disneyland. Orwell's vision of a panopticon state that exercised control over its population through surveillance and fear never took root in the liberal West. Orwell's fears, it seems, were unfounded. But perhaps Orwell's vision was not wrong, but merely naive. Perhaps the panopticon state was superseded by a newer, more efficient, and more subtle mode of power and social control. In the book 1984, a weaponized gaze is directed from a powerful and invisible center to a powerless and visible periphery. In the year 1984, however, everything was reversed. No one had a surveillance camera in their home. Everyone, however, had a television, which they watched, on average, 6 hours a day. In the year 1984, the center was still powerful and the periphery powerless, but the center is visible and the periphery invisible. Those in power are visible and omnipresent. Those on the periphery are unseen and anonymous. The population is controlled through the images from the center of wealth, youth, beauty, and sex. The basis of control is not fear, but desire. This is not the hard totalitarianism of surveillance and fear, but a soft totalitarianism of consumerism, advertising, and the mass production of desire. This is the new mode of power, of mind over mind. But how does this power work? And what ideology does it use to justify itself? If advertising is the propaganda of consumerism, what does advertising tell us about the ideology it serves? Every ideology creates a narrative of our lives, a three-act story of problem, struggle, and reward. In Christianity, the problem is we are enslaved by sin. The struggle is faith and good works. The reward is heaven. For Marx, we are enslaved by class exploitation. The struggle is revolution, and the reward is a classless society. For Freud, we are enslaved by neurotic unhappiness. The struggle is therapy, and the reward, as Freud himself said, is ordinary human misery. In each narrative, humans are posited to be flawed and therefore unfree. It is only through struggle, of faith, of revolution, of therapy, that we free ourselves from our flaws and find fulfillment. So what is the narrative of consumerism? What is the flaw we must overcome to find fulfillment? The story consumerism tells us is that we are by nature desiring beings. The problem is that we desire goods and services. The struggle is to work and make money. And the reward, if we succeed, is to become rich and to thereby fulfill our desires. The source of our discontents, consumerism tells us, is not sin or exploitation or neurosis, but desire and our endless thirst for its fulfillment. The standard critique of consumerism tells us that our desires are not natural, but rather fabricated by the machinery of consumerism itself. Thus, consumerism does not manufacture products in order to satisfy desires. Rather, its fundamental task is to manufacture desire in order to sell products. But not all desires are equal. Big cars have a higher profit margin than small cars. New clothes have a higher profit margin than used clothes. Processed foods have a higher profit margin than raw foods. So by the logic of consumerism, goods that are new or big or processed are more desirable than the small or recycled or raw. This is the standard critique of consumerism we're all familiar with, that advertising is capitalist propaganda designed to induce us to buy stuff we don't need, with money we don't have, to impress people we don't know. What Thorstein Veblen in 1925 called conspicuous consumption. Yet Veblen went a step further. For him, consumption was not about desire. That was a fig leaf to disguise its true nature. Rather, conspicuous consumption was about class hierarchy and social status. We do not buy a Rolex because it tells time more accurately. We do not buy a Ferrari to drive to work more quickly. Rather, we buy these things to advertise our place within a hierarchy of status and respectability. As Veblen observed, the more useful and utilitarian a good or service was, the lower its perceived status. Thus, the low status conferred upon farming, plumbing, and sanitation. Conversely, the more unnecessary a good or service, the more useless and conspicuously wasteful, the higher its status. Thus, the high status conferred on diamonds, yachts, works of art, movie stars, and postgraduate education. Consumerism was less about the fulfillment of desire than the pursuit of status through the purchase and display of conspicuously useless and wasteful goods and services. To Veblen, this was the underlying ideology of consumerism, that life is a competition for status, for respect, for the esteem of others. And the way we win status, the measure of our lives and our worth as human beings, is through our ability to purchase and consume as conspicuously and wastefully as possible. These values of conspicuous and wasteful consumption add up to a vision of life that might be termed the cult of the winner. The winner owns a big expensive house. He drives a big expensive car. Everything the winner owns is new, big, expensive, and therefore as conspicuously wasteful as possible. Anyone who falls short of such a life, implicitly, is a loser. Today, the hierarchies of status have evolved. There is still the ethos of materialist consumption, mansions, sports cars, yachts. But this is increasingly the province of Russian oligarchs and the nouveau riche. Today, there is also an ethos of non-materialist consumption. The elite travel to distant and obscure destinations, attend silent meditation retreats, earn doctoral degrees. They visit museums, attend symphonies, read the latest bestseller, and otherwise engage in the pursuit of cultural capital. While avoiding the vulgar materialism of the Gilded Age, they nevertheless advertise their status through the profligate expenditure of disposable time and non-productive effort. Yoga resorts, culinary tours, gap years, semesters abroad, graduate degrees. These are the new status markers. None of these things, however, can make one a real winner. To be a real winner today, it is no longer enough to be well-traveled, well-read, well-connected. It is no longer enough to be merely rich. The ultimate reward in Christianity is heaven. The ultimate reward in Marxism is a classless society. What, then, is the ultimate reward in consumerism? Here we borrow an insight from Slavoj Žižek. The ultimate want, Žižek tells us, is to be wanted. The ultimate desire is to be desired. So the ultimate achievement in consumerism is to become wanted and desired, to turn oneself into a product, to become famous, to be a celebrity. Within a consumer society, the successful celebrity achieves a kind of secular transcendence, a holy status, by turning him or herself into a brand, an object, something that can be bought and sold. To succeed in consumerism, to win at being a winner, it is no longer enough to be rich. One must also become famous. And the more attention you attract, the more clicks you generate, the higher the ratings, the bigger the winner you are. Which brings us unavoidably to the figure of Donald Trump.
My whole life has been a life of accumulation. Money, money, I want more money, I don't even know why, you know, it's like, just keep going.
The makers of this film have no interest in litigating Trump's politics. Trump himself seems to have no real interest in politics per se. What he cares about is ratings and reviews and crowd size. Trump inherited his wealth, $400 million, from his father. But being rich wasn't enough. He pursued the spotlight of celebrity and became a household name, an image, a brand. After six bankruptcies, he left real estate for showbiz, to be on TV once a week, then left showbiz for politics, to be on TV every day. He transformed himself from an outer borough rich kid to the inescapable center of the world's attention economy. In doing so, he made himself into the ultimate winner. Trump exercises power not through surveillance, but through the dominance of public attention. As such, Trump represents the ultimate reversal of the panopticon and the final inversion of Orwell's vision. Today, Big Brother is no longer watching us. Today, we are all watching Big Brother.
My whole life I've been greedy, greedy, greedy. I've grabbed all the money I could get. I'm so greedy.
Trump is too easily dismissed by his critics as a vulgar clown, a reality TV star who turned reality itself into a show and made himself the star. But he may also be seen as a cautionary tale, the apotheosis of the cult of the winner. Trump's entire life is an exercise in branding. He puts his name on everything he acquires. Hotels, casinos, planes, wives, children, all beautiful, wasteful, and useless, and offers them up for public display.
We're going to win so much, you may even get tired of winning, and you'll say, please.
His life, a Mobius loop of television appearances and television consumption of tweets and retweeting, suggests the Hall of Mirrors narcissism that is the reductio ad absurdum of our consumer culture.
We're going to win more!
But this Hall of Mirrors narcissism, this feedback loop of performance and review, is no longer the province of the rich and famous. Today, the culture of narcissism is for everyone. Today, everyone can be a winner. In the year 1984, power worked on a broadcast model. Stories and images were produced at the center by the rich and famous. The rest of us sat on the periphery and watched. To be visible was to be a winner. To be anonymous was not. As a mode of social control, the reverse panopticon worked. Mesmerized by images of wealth and beauty, seized by the desire for status and social distinction, the population was rendered docile by the hamster wheel of consumerism, working longer and longer hours to buy more and more stuff. Debt and obesity skyrocketed, as did corporate profits, CEO pay, and income inequality. The soft totalitarianism of consumerism proved to be more comprehensive and effective in controlling the population than the hard totalitarianism that Orwell feared. By 1990, McDonald's was in Red Square. 30 years later, however, the old broadcast model is obsolete. Today, everyone has a camera and a TV station in their pocket. Today, everyone can generate their own images, tell their own stories. But rather than tell new stories, we often retell the old one, casting ourselves in the lead role. We curate images of ourselves, not as we are, but as we wish to be seen, as winners. Like Trump, our lives become a performance, an exercise in self-branding for an invisible and all-seeing audience. Rather than escape the reverse panopticon, we have internalized it, and we monitor our ratings as obsessively as Trump does. How many clicks, how many likes, how many followers. Once, the big eye that watched over us belonged to God. In 1984, the big eye belonged to the state. Today, it is the audience, invisible and omnipresent, punishing and rewarding, judgmental and wrathful, all-seeing and all-powerful, that has become the new God. As exhibitionists, we have all become Winston Smith. As voyeurs, we have all become Big Brother. The genius of the old panopticon was that prisoners presumed they were under constant surveillance and so modified their behavior, even if no one was watching. Today, we live in a state of self-surveillance and modify our behavior accordingly, acting out the role of the winner. even if no one is watching. As such, we have become complicit in our own subjugation. For most of Western history, the classic virtues were unchanging: hard work, thrift, humility, charity, mercy, chasteness, generosity. Everything your mother taught you. As Max Weber pointed out, early capitalism derived much of its underlying ethos from the Protestant work ethic. To be rich was proof of one's hard work and thrift. Respectability was a sign of chasteness and humility. Status was derived from charity, fellowship, generosity. In 1889, Andrew Carnegie wrote, "Surplus wealth is a sacred trust which its possessor is bound to administer in his lifetime for the good of the community." He concluded, "The man who dies rich dies disgraced." Today, social Darwinism has replaced Christianity as the underlying ethos of capitalism. Consumerism has turned these values on their head. Instead of restraint, it celebrates gluttony. Instead of modesty, lust. Instead of generosity, greed. Instead of humility, pride. Instead of kindness, envy. Instead of mercy, wrath. Instead of hard work, sloth. With few exceptions, consumerism promotes and celebrates values that were once seen as the path to ruin and despair. And so we become ever more anxious, stressed, distracted, depressed, overweight, sleep deprived, in debt, dissatisfied. So who's to blame for this mess? Who are the bad guys in this story? At this point, the standard critique tends to find an easy villain in the rich and powerful: Wall Street, Madison Avenue, Hollywood. But this ignores a more complicated truth. It is a truism today that fame can be a prison. In winning fame, one loses anonymity, privacy, the freedom to move through the world, unmolested by the gaze of the camera. But the cult of the winner may also be a mental prison for those at the top who, like Trump, spend their lives chasing after the applause of the crowd and the phantoms of status. As such, the self-branded celebrity is merely the most obvious victim of the reverse panopticon state, as any supermarket tabloid will attest. Who then benefits from this system of overconsumption, narcissism, and self-surveillance? And how does one escape?
The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room.
You can see it when you look out your window, or when you turn on your television.
It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind.
Remember those movies where aliens invade the Earth, take over the government and plunder the environment? Humans are brainwashed and cast into servitude, working ceaselessly to enrich their alien overlords? In these movies, there's often a class of pod people who collaborate with the aliens and enjoy a modicum of privilege. And there's a handful of freedom fighters, a scrappy band of misfits who live outside the system and fight back against the soulless aliens and their bootlicking human collaborators. Today, this is not a movie.
Welcome to the real world.
Today, this is your life. Today, the aliens who have plundered the environment and taken over the government are called corporations. You may not have declared war on them, but they have declared war on you. Every second of every day, the machine works to make you addicted to sugar, fat, caffeine, nicotine, gasoline, debt, political outrage, and social media. Every second of every day, the machine seeks to take your money, your time, to capture your attention and your data, commodify them, and sell them to advertisers. Every second of every day, the machine works to make you consume as wastefully and conspicuously as possible: food, medication, goods and services, leisure. To do so, the machine wants you to become envious, greedy, gluttonous, lustful, wrathful, prideful, and slothful. A class of pod people collaborate with these aliens and enjoy a modicum of privilege, but in the end, they are just as indentured as everyone else. No one is more servile to the corporation than the CEO. Who then are the freedom fighters, and how does one fight back?
You take the blue pill. The story ends.
You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised.
The genius of the soft totalitarian state is that it's voluntary. We are complicit in our own subjugation, but that means we also have the freedom to opt out. If you own a lot of stuff, big, expensive stuff, maybe you're not a winner. Maybe you're a cog in the machine. On the other hand, if you only own what you need and your stuff is inexpensive or recycled, maybe you're not a loser. Maybe you're a freedom fighter. And the freedom you're fighting for is your own. So maybe an apple is better than a bag of chips. A glass of water is better than a big gulp. A book is better than a TV. A thrift store is cooler than a boutique. An old bike is better than a new Ferrari. A cheap rent is better than an expensive mortgage. In her career, Dorothea Lange took thousands of photographs of migrant workers, sharecroppers, prisoners. In doing so, she changed the way America saw itself. Her camera, facing outward, was a tool of art. In her lifetime, she posed for a single self-portrait. In 2015, Kim Kardashian published a 450-page book of selfies. It was titled Selfish. Her camera, facing inward, was a narcissist's mirror. Kardashian, like Trump, is a celebrity, a brand, a product. As a winner in the economy of attention and an addict in the culture of narcissism, she has made herself prisoner, both internally and externally, of the reverse panopticon state.
And I just pose away and take about 300 photos until I get the perfect selfie.
Like Winston Smith, her life is dominated by the camera and by the invisible audience on the other side of the lens.
The revolution will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised. The revolution will be no rerun, brothers. The revolution will be live.
In the book 1984, power is exercised through fear, coercion, surveillance, being watched by those at the top. Today, power is also exercised through the mass production of desire, weaponized status competition, and the hegemony of a spectator society, of watching those at the top. You can watch corporate sports or play sports yourself. You can watch corporate musicians or make your own music. You can watch a corporate talk show or have a conversation. You can take the blue pill of consumerism and spend the rest of your life staring at a screen, passive, docile, a cog in the machine. Or you can live your life. In 1984, Winston Smith didn't have a choice. The telescreen in his apartment could never be turned off. You have a screen in your house, on your desk, in your hand. You are giving it your attention right now. But you can turn it off. Every ideology presents itself as the natural order of things. Christianity and Marxism are monotheisms that explain the world and give us values and ideals that govern our lives. Today, consumerism has become its own monotheism, so invisible and ubiquitous it's like the water we swim in. What is the point of life, if not to be a winner? To what should we aspire, if not to be rich and famous? Here, the standard critique returns us to the classic virtues, kindness, charity, thrift, humility, mercy, generosity, to be a good person, like your mother taught you. The makers of this film have nothing against the classic virtues or against your mother. But perhaps there is something else we can aspire to, better than being a winner or a good person. Perhaps we may aspire to become ourselves. Perhaps the monotheism of consumerism can be replaced not by another monotheism, but by a kind of ideological polytheism. Let us return to the narrative of problem, struggle, reward. For a Buddhist, the problem is suffering, the struggle is meditation, the reward is tranquility, and perhaps enlightenment. For a scholar, the problem is ignorance, the struggle is study, and the reward is knowledge and perhaps even wisdom. For the activist, the problem is injustice, the struggle is activism, the reward is social progress, perhaps even justice. In each case, the self begins as raw and unformed and is transformed through a regime of daily practice. The transformation of the self from uncultivated to cultivated, from ordinary to extraordinary, is a struggle of daily and deliberate practice, of exertion and exhaustion, of trial and error, of self-challenge and self-overcoming. Nietzsche called it the struggle to become what one is. The cultivation of the self requires exertion, risk, perseverance, discipline, exhaustion, and the inevitability of disappointment, falling short, failure. It requires that you challenge yourself, that you become active. This is what consumerism seeks to thwart. What consumerism wants, above all, is to make us passive, to make us alienated from our lives, from our labor, from each other, to sit at home and watch other people talk and cook and play sports and make music and have sex and live life, to be spectators, cogs in the machine, consumers. We all have one life, one chance to become whomever we might be. And just as we struggle to free ourselves from sin, from exploitation, from our own neuroses, we may also struggle to free ourselves from the reverse panopticon of consumerism and the cult of the winner. We may thereby win the freedom to choose our own path, to pursue our own ideals. The Christian gives up everything to become a saint. The Buddhist gives up everything for enlightenment. The radical gives up everything to change the world. The surfer lives for the wave. The climber risks everything for the climb. No one can tell you who you are or what you may become. Your life is your life, and you are the author of yourself.